Joining us now on the debate for the full hour tonight. In the nation's capital, two professors from the University of Ottawa's School of Political Studies, Jennifer Walner and Martin Papillon. And with us here in studio, Jamie Cameron, professor in the Faculty of Law at Osgoode Hall Law School, David Schneiderman, professor in the Faculty of Law at the University of Toronto, and Ron Graham, author of The Last Act, Pierre Trudeau, The Gang of Eight, and The Fight for Canada. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for joining us today on this eve of the 30th anniversary of our Constitution's repatriation. I take you back 30-plus years ago, Pierre Trudeau in the House of Commons reporting that, yes, we seem to have a deal. Roll tape, please.
We have, by consensus, constitutionalized an endeavor began in this House more than a year ago to bring Canada's constitution to Canada, to have in it an amending formula, and to have in it a charter of rights binding on all of us.
All of those negotiations, of course, culminating 30 years ago tomorrow on Parliament Hill, Queen Elizabeth II came to sign the new constitution, and for the first time in our history, we had our own homegrown constitution with an amending formula and a charter of rights and freedoms. David, let's start here. We have a lot of new Canadians who watch this program, a lot of people who haven't been living here for the last 30 years, so I don't want to assume that everybody understands why this was a big deal or even why it was necessary. So let's start there. What was the problem in Canada at the time that Pierre Trudeau had determined we needed to fix?
Well, the Canadian Constitution was an enactment of the United Kingdom Parliament acting on behalf of the Empire. And so we had a version of that in 1867, which divided legislative authority between the federal and provincial governments, and little else. And so the endeavor was to modernize the Canadian Constitution by bringing the Constitution home, so to speak, so that Canada would have control over future amendments, and also include a new Bill of Rights that had not been included in 1867.
Jennifer, was it really considered so egregious that we didn't have our own made-in-Canada homegrown constitution at the time?
I think that that was certainly an issue. This idea that we needed to sever the last kind of colonial ties and not go hat in hand to the British Parliament in order to change our constitution and define ourselves as a sovereign state, I think that was kind of a significant thing for Trudeau. But certainly to me, the more important aspect was the Charter of Rights and Freedoms.
We'll get to all of this as we go along. Ron, did Mr. and Mrs. Everyday Canada feel this yawning, gaping absence of a homegrown constitution in our daily lives?
Not so much in the daily lives. I agree that the patriation wouldn't have driven the agenda totally without the charter. It wasn't on everybody's top 10 list. But the significant thing was it was the last colonial link, that in order to change it, we had to go to a foreign country and ask them to change our constitution for us. We were the only independent country in the world that didn't have full control of its own constitution. So it was a strange anomaly that had been going on after 50 years of negotiations, 100 and something years of federation, that had to be changed at some point because it was undignified, and if nothing else.
This is what I want to follow on with you, Jamie, because it wasn't like this was the first attempt to repatriate the Constitution, get first ministers together to negotiate. Why had this always been, in the past, such a tough nut to crack?
Well, I think it was because it was so difficult for the federal government and the 10 provinces to agree on an amending formula. And the odd thing about the 1867 Constitution is that they didn't see a need to include an amending formula because the Constitution would be amended the same way it was brought into existence by statute of the United Kingdom. And so there was a gap in the original constitution, but in order to fix that gap, the federal government and the provinces had to agree on an amending formula.
An amending formula meaning what?
A formula by which the constitution would be amended. So usually for constitutional amendment, it's not just an ordinary act of legislation that can amend a constitution, but there are formal rules that determine how many governments have to agree and whether it's unanimity or some other formula that is required for agreement between the governments before the Constitution can be amended. And we did not have that. And so it was just an anomaly, but it was one we were unable to fix for a very long period of time.
Martin, Pierre Trudeau not only wanted the Constitution to come home, as it were, but he also wanted, as we've heard mentioned before, an accompanying Charter of Rights and Freedoms. And I want to tackle that angle in this way. Is that to say that before we got the Charter 30 years ago, we really didn't have anything in this country that seriously guaranteed our civil rights?
No, it's not completely true. Of course, there was the Bill of Rights, and a province like Quebec, for example, had adopted their own Charter of Rights previous to that. So there were already existing legislations that protected individual rights in Canada, not to mention that as part of a system of common law, a lot of the basic civil rights were already part of that that general system. But the point of it, of course, is that the biggest difference, of course, is that by entrenching the Charter in the Constitution, what it means essentially is that both the federal parliament and the legislative assemblies of the provinces are bound by that charter, by that Charter of Rights and Freedoms. So it makes a significant difference, not only in legal judicial terms, but also in political terms.
Okay, for those of us who are not law students, David, I want you to amplify on that, because John Diefenbaker, when he was Prime Minister, did pass a Bill of Rights, which was an act of Parliament in Canada. It wasn't from Britain, it was homegrown. Why would that have been inadequate to guarantee our civil rights?
Well, it might have had more force if the judges had been more forceful in acting under its rubric. They were quite timid. The Diefenbaker Bill of Rights in 1960 was an ordinary statute of the Parliament of Canada, binding only the Government of Canada. And so wasn't entrenched in the way that Martin has described it. That is, it could easily be amended. It could be repealed in the next parliamentary session. Similarly, provincial human rights codes or bills of rights also could be amended, repealed, right, the day after they were enacted. They weren't entrenched. They didn't require this extraordinary threshold of consensus that Jamie described in order to change it. It's important to note that there were only a few provinces that had bills of rights per se, for instance, providing some sort of guarantee for freedom of expression, to take one example. Most every province had a statutory human rights code that would prohibit discrimination on particular types of grounds, which is an element of the Canadian Charter of Rights and Freedoms, and those one finds across the country pre-1982. Pre-1982, there were far fewer bills of rights per se. Tommy Douglas's Bill of Rights in Saskatchewan was one of the first to entrench fundamental freedoms, things beyond equality rights, non-discrimination rights.
But of course that was only for Saskatchewan.
That was only for Saskatchewan, and again, an ordinary statute, like any other bill.
Martin, I want to follow up with you on a Quebec angle here. The Prime Minister of the day, Pierre Trudeau, was a Quebecer. The Minister of Justice of the day, Jean Chrétien, was a Quebecer. Do you think that was just a coincidence that the two of the senior most people on this file were Quebecers who perhaps would have particularly keenly wanted that break with the United Kingdom finally to come?
I'm not sure there's any specific relation to the fact that they were Quebecers with this idea of breaking with the United Kingdom. But what is clear, however, is that Trudeau and Chrétien and other members of that government had a very clear view of the kind of Canada they wanted to build. The kind of Canada they wanted to build was the Canada of that we see today, essentially, the Canada of the Charter, a Canada that is built around this idea of equal citizens across the country belonging to a single national political community. And the Charter was definitely an element in building that Canada, defining that Canada. And that's actually part of the reason, of course, why Quebec was reluctant to embark in this adventure.
And Jennifer, let me get really pedantic here, but you know that if you type the word patriation on your computer, you get that little squiggly red line underneath saying the word doesn't exist. So it's true. Use the word repatriation, which suggests that we're doing it again, even though we didn't do it for the first time. And I notice already on this program, many of you have interchangeably used the words patriate and repatriate. Right. Want to help us out here? What's really going on?
Ooh, that's actually, we're getting into prorogation periods here too, right? Where we're learning all about new words, thanks to the Government of Canada trying to initiate new things for us. To be perfectly honest, I'm not the distinction in terms of patriation or repatriation, this idea that you are a country with kind of a constitution that you're not in total control over, does seem to be a real anomaly. And so this idea that you're bringing this back to your homeland, if we think about the words repatriate, then that might kind of help us to understand what was going on here. I also just wanted to build off of, for just a moment, on Jamie's discussion about the amending formula, because mm-hmm. This is particularly important for federal countries. And because a federation involves a division of powers between at least two orders of government, the idea is that the basket of powers that's given to or allocated to one order of government can't be unilaterally changed by another order of government. And so finding this kind of amending formula was quite crucial for a federal country, actually, so that there is some sort of way that we can negotiate these spaces between the two orders of government.
Gotcha.
So I just wanted to...
Mm-hmm. Clarify that. Okay, repatriation versus patriation. Any difference, Jamie?
Well, I just wanted to say that maybe we call it repatriation, or some of us call it repatriation, because, of course, the Constitution was drafted in Canada, and some of us are familiar with the Confederation debate. So the Constitution came from Canada and was enacted by Britain, and so maybe that's why we say repatriation instead of patriation. And just to be clear to everyone who's listening to the show, we did write our own constitution. It's just that it was enacted by Britain.
It was enacted by the British Parliament.
We did write it in 1867 as well.
Yes.
The year we became a country.
Yeah.
Okay. Ron, help us out with this. We want to start to tell the story now. Pierre Trudeau comes up with this constitutional package, and he puts it out there, and originally two provinces sign on, Ontario and New Brunswick. Take us back to the time. Did he think, with only 2 out of 10 provinces signing on, that was enough support for him to proceed?
I think you have to actually go back the earlier step to May 1980, the year before, or roughly the year before, with the Quebec referendum, where the federal side won 60-40. Trudeau had promised a change to the reforms. He came out of that with a lot of goodwill towards Canada and a sense that we have to move forward. He spent the summer negotiating 12 powers among the provinces in a very intense period, trying to find a series of changes in both central institutions and powers, as well as charter and patriation. When that failed in September 1980, he then said, look, 50 years plus is enough. I've made this promise. I can't get it. There's a total roadblock here. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to divide out of these 12 items the two simplest things, patriation and the charter. Simplest because they were the most popular. Very, very popular right across the country, 80-90%, including in Quebec. And they were taking power not from any level of government, but from, they were taking power from all levels of government on the charter, but they were basically putting power in the people. So he very cleverly called this the people's package. And he said, we'll get the people's package, these two simple things, and then we'll go on to talk about the powers package. So October 1980, he basically introduces patriation and the charter and says, we're going to go ahead, because we can't get agreement, we're going to go ahead and just get these two things. And we can legally act unilaterally. It became a question during the course of the year, but basically we can act unilaterally. And that began the process where at that time only two allies came on, Ontario and New Brunswick, saying, yeah, we've also gone through this for 10, 15 years, Davis and Hatfield. We understand it. We have got a commitment to Quebecers to deliver something. So we'll move ahead on that, and then we agree. And the other eight formed a gang to try to stop them.
Okay, hold off on the gang of eight. We'll get to them in a second. 2 out of 10 provinces signing on. Had Trudeau just gone ahead and done that, would that have been legitimate?
He would have had problems, I think, arguing that it was legitimate. He had a point. It was legal in a strictly legal sense, but not in a conventional sense. So it was, he would have had a lot of trouble going forward, I think.
He did have a lot of trouble going forward.
Yeah, he did have a lot of, irrespective of that, but certainly would have had more trouble, I think.
Jennifer, what's your view on that? Whether Ontario was there, that's a big province. New Brunswick, not so big, but two out of 10 on side, would that have been adequate to go ahead?
Well, I don't think so. The optics of the situation was pretty grim. I realize the Supreme Court ruled in the patriation reference case that technically the federal government could advance, but in the other opinion, they definitely declared that under constitutional convention, this represents a significant change to the powers of the provinces, and that they should not just go forward unilaterally, that this would undermine the federal principle, in fact. And so the idea of just moving forward just with Ontario and New Brunswick, I don't think would have passed muster.
Ron, a follow-up?
Could I pick up on that? Because what happened, say, October 80, he decides to move forward unilaterally. Almost a year later, September 81, after several court references, the Supreme Court of Canada says exactly what Jennifer just said. Basically, it's technically legal, but it's unconstitutional.
I think Trudeau said it's legal, but not nice.
Yeah. The court was even a little stronger than that. And so they basically said you need more than two. You need a bunch. We don't know what it is, but you don't need everybody, which was significant.
But you need more
a
than
bunch.
Two.
Yeah. So that forced him to the table, which you'll get to in a second, no doubt, of the November conference. And he was forced back to it by basically saying, okay, the court has boxed me in here. The optics, as Jennifer just said, look terrible. I will go back for one last chance in November. And if we fail then I'm going on and full steam ahead.
Jamie, help us understand what the Supreme Court was saying in that case. Because I remember when the decision came out, people thought, oh my God, what a typically Canadian compromise of a decision. What did they say?
Well, I mean, here's the riddle. The court basically said by majority vote that it was legally constitutional for the Prime Minister to proceed unilaterally, and what that meant was that there were no legal obstacles in the Constitution itself. So he was legally authorized to go forward unilaterally if he wanted to try and do that. And actually, some would say that the court ought to have stopped at that point and not gone on to answer the second question, which is more of a political question. And the second question was whether it was nonetheless unconstitutional in the quote-unquote conventional sense for him to go forward in the absence of quote-unquote substantial provincial consent. And so the idea is one of a constitutional convention, which is not it is a legal concept, but it's a political rule. It's not a legal rule. So it's a difference between a legal rule, and he had authority under the legal rule, but the political rule, the rule of convention, by a majority of the court, said that what he was doing was unconstitutional. So, some find it very interesting that the court chose to put its weight behind that question when the easy way, perhaps, for the court to avoid a strong role for itself in this whole episode would have been not to answer that question.
Martin, what did you think of that court's decision, which was, it's legal, but it's unconventional?
Yes, well, it's the Supreme Court actually said it's legal, but it may not be legitimate. And this is actually, I think, the important word there, or the important concept that we should retain from this. I think everyone's absolutely right that the court did say, it would be legal, so it would be constitutional to a certain extent. The difference between convention and formal legal rules is quite simply that the court cannot enforce a convention. So the Supreme Court could not enforce a decision, go against a decision of the government to, for example, violate a convention. But politically, in terms of democratic legitimacy, the Supreme Court clearly stated, and I've restated many, many times since, that conventions are extremely important. Constitutional conventions are part of the bedrock of our democracy, of our constitutional democracy. So you cannot violate these constitutional conventions without certain consequences in terms of the democratic legitimacy of your action. And I think that Trudeau understood that very well, and hence was not going to act against this decision because of the political consequences. The optics would have been quite dramatic. That being said, I want to add something else about the process and what was going on at the time. I think it's absolutely right that the 1980 Quebec referendum is really important to understand the unfolding of event and what we're talking about later on, because the very reason we had a round of negotiation, constitutional negotiation, starting, by the way, the negotiation informally started the day after the referendum. Jean Chrétien went around the country to talk, to open, to set an agenda for negotiation the day after the 1980 referendum. To start negotiation to bring back Quebec into, was not bringing back Quebec, but it was fulfilling the promise made during the referendum to adapt the Canadian Federation to the demands of Quebec. So, and what happened essentially is after a round of negotiation, Trudeau changed the agenda, essentially unilaterally changed the agenda from a Quebec focused onto a sort of so-called people's package. Fair enough, but what happens then is that the Quebec government that was negotiated and engaged in negotiation with that perspective, this idea of sort of adapting the constitution to Quebec's demand, was then drawn into these negotiations that were not at all about the redistribution of power, which was the very reason why Quebec was engaging there.
Interesting.
So you see that the optics became very different when Trudeau withdrew the redistribution of power from the negotiation.
Ron.
Yeah, just to follow up on the court, a couple of things. First of all, it's really important to understand, as complex as that decision was, the Supreme Court decision, that first of all, unlike the demand of the province or the question that the provinces asked the court said you don't need unanimity. Before that, basically the whole system had been blocked because everybody had to agree, or everybody thought everybody had to agree, and the court actually said you don't need unanimity. Became very important as part of what unfolded. And the second thing, which became very important, is that it said you don't need Quebec as a founding partner or whatever language you want to put around it.
And Quebec always thought they had
it. And because they killed a deal in the 60s and they killed a deal in the 70s and they thought they could kill a deal here. So whether by law or convention, Quebec thought it had a veto. And in that decision and subsequent another decision, the court said no. But the importance of that decision was, yes, Trudeau changed the game, but and yes, the court forced him back. But after the court, what was his choices? Do you drop the whole thing after 50 years and say, okay, we've wasted all this time and all this energy and over something that everybody loves by huge majorities, even in Quebec, or do I press ahead? And what was really interesting on the legal conventional thing is that he was saying, I don't know where it's going, but in the wake of the failure of November, if we fail again, I'm going to Britain. If they won't give it to me, I'm declaring unilateral declaration of independence from Britain on the grounds of how dare they stop a sovereign country like Canada. And secondly, if Canadians object to it, I'm going to have a national referendum on it and I'm going to win hands down. So he knew that it was going to be difficult, but he was going to get this thing.
So a lot of poker being played here
in
November
absolutely.
Of 1981. A lot of poker going on. They say in baseball you can't tell the players about a scorecard. So give us a scorecard here. Who were the big players going up to these negotiations in November 1981?
Well, I think that all the premiers, but I guess on the premiers from the western provinces, I think had quite a bit of clout in the process, and of course Ontario. And
but not all provinces are equal. We know that. So Bill Davis in Ontario would have been particularly influential.
Yes,
Peter Lougheed in Alberta.
Yes, Alan Blakeney. Sterling Lyon
in Manitoba,
and those would be the main ones, I think. And they were certainly the ones who
and Levesque,
were.
Of course.
Sorry.
And Levesque, of course.
Oh, Levesque, of course. Yeah. Yes, I took that as being assumed that we were speaking of him earlier. But those were the main participants as things were coming to a head in that critical period when the renegotiation took place in November.
So David, they get together at the Chateau Laurier Hotel. The negotiations start. How does it go?
Not so well. The Gang of Eight are holding on. There seems to be, and Ron has documented this quite well, there seems to be some dissension among the gang, and Levesque is peeled off by the proposal of a referendum, which then alarms, I think, the other premiers and their staff who meet overnight on November the 4th and devise what we call the Kitchen Accord.
Let's just remind everybody, I don't want to go too fast here, but you got Ontario and New Brunswick supporting Trudeau for patriation, and then you've got this Gang of Eight other provinces who are opposed.
Correct.
And somehow Peter Lougheed and the Separatist Premier of Quebec are in the same gang together. How is that?
It's a motley crew of different political orientations, sovereignists, federalists, and different political parties. Mm-hmm. You know, New Democrats and Conservatives.
Go ahead, Jennifer.
Sorry, there needs to be a bit of a clarification, though. The Gang of Eight was concerned with Trudeau's drive to unilaterally patriate the Constitution with the Charter of Rights and Freedoms. The provincial premiers were not comfortable with the idea of a Charter of Rights and Freedoms because they saw that as an affront to their parliamentary sovereignty, their legislative sovereignty. So the idea that citizens of the provinces could go to the courts and say, this legislation is not respecting my rights, that really was disquieting for the premiers. And so that was a kind of coalition of the willing then. To come together and say to Trudeau, look, we will patriate the Constitution, we'll do that, with an amending formula and with an opt-out clause for federal funding. And that was it. That was that was a commitment among the Gang of Eight, including Levesque, going into the negotiations.
But David, they're all politicians, and they can all read polls. And they all knew, as Ron said, that this thing was wildly popular. And yet they opposed it anyway. How come?
Well, I think Jennifer's stated very clearly that it was about provincial power and authority, and the premiers were going to lose some of that in the process of entrenching a Charter of Rights. They also wanted to have control over any amendment of the Constitution and the terms upon which it would be amended. They feared going to the people, which is, I think, regrettable in retrospect.
Why would a politician fear going to the people?
I think
that's what they do all the time.
Yeah, I think that they feared, from what I can tell, that a referendum on these questions would be divisive, particularly around language rights. So the fear was that, for instance, Albertans would vote against a rights package that included official language rights. But that's not entirely clear, particularly if you had provincial leadership at the helm, right, who were promoting the a package in a nationwide referendum. And I think it would have been ideally preferred if the premiers had, 9 out of 10 were on side, and there was a referendum, a consultation with the people.
Ron, I want you to set us up for what now, 30 years later, has become legend, this story of the two attorneys general of Ontario and Saskatchewan and the federal minister of justice, McMurtry, Romano and Chrétien, meeting in a kitchen in the Chateau Laurier Hotel late at night and essentially hammering something out. Tell us that story.
Well, they, as I argue, or show in the book, the players are divided about the importance of that event. It happened, but how important or significant was is the source of an event. So as David's right, they were meeting across the street from the Chateau Laurier in this government conference center. They began on Monday. Monday was a feeling out. Tuesday was a little bit more feeling out. It looked like it might fall apart, but nobody really wanted it to fall apart. Wednesday was this very dramatic moment when it looked like it was falling apart. And Trudeau says, let's go to the people. Trudeau had a referendum, to pick up David's point, in his amending formula. He thought the Constitution should go to the people, and the premiers took that out. And so he said again, okay, we have a problem. I don't know if I'm right. I don't know if you're right. Let's go to the people. And Levesque jumped up and said, yeah, okay, I agree. And this was revenge for May 80. And it was bluff, and it was impetuous.
But that ticked off the other Gang of Eight.
Well, what happened is they had a deal, the Gang of Eight, that nobody was going to move without consulting the others and being on side. And nobody had moved. That's why it was holding solid. That's why there was such a block for those first 2 days.
Did Trudeau set that trap intentionally, do you think?
Well, he didn't think that Levesque was going to pick it up. He wanted to be able to showboat it to the people. Look, I tried to get to you. You as the ultimate deciders, but these guys are power mongers, and et cetera, et cetera. So he didn't think that Levesque would be stupid enough, quiz quote, to pick it up.
And he did.
And he did. For all kinds of reasons.
Levesque hadn't consulted, I think, his staff.
Anybody. It was a total surprise. Yeah. But the person who really was shocked in that was Lougheed. Lougheed was in bed with a separatist all the way through the year because they were both, has been established, trying to block this deal for their own reasons. Lougheed was coming out of the NEP, the energy crisis. It was, all that stuff. So he was in bed with Levesque for different purposes. But nevertheless, they were tight. And the purpose was to stop this thing. When Levesque suddenly says, oh, by the way, I'm going with Trudeau, and Trudeau jumps up and says, we have an entente between Quebec. The one who was shaken most was Lougheed. And he started saying, wow, that's weird. I'm never going to get a deal from Levesque. He thought he could get a deal from Levesque.
Okay, hold off for a second. I'm going to hold off on the kitchen because I know Martin wants to get in on this point. Hold up. We're coming back to the kitchen. But was it a mistake, Martin, for Levesque to peel off without telling the other Gang of Eight, yes, I'll go for the referendum?
Well, it was a strategic mistake in that specific context. I think that's absolutely true. Although we have to realize that we focused a lot on the specific events of that night, that kitchen agreement, so on and so forth. But as far as I understand the way it unfolded, this was something that was in the preparation, in the making for quite a long time. there had been informal meetings between these three and between other groups. And the sort of the Gang of Eight, the group of the coalition of the provinces, was already weakening and already falling apart to a certain extent, mostly because provinces, except Quebec, were quite willing to let go of the opting out clause, which was essentially to replace the veto. So Quebec agreed to that agreement with the seven other provinces and essentially agreed to give up its veto in exchange for an opting out, a right to opt out any amendment to the Constitution that would reduce its authority with compensation. And so this is all technical, but the point is that this the opting out clause was what Quebec held on, and the other provinces were willing to give up that opting out clause. So the coalition was already falling apart, and so the reason why I think Lévesque agreed to that referendum or opened the door. He didn't formally agree. He said, fine, put it to the people. My position will then fall back to we want a veto.
Okay, let me get us back into the kitchen.
That agreement fell apart. So the whole kitchen affair, I think is the kitchen is actually the focal point of something that's unfolded for a much longer period of time. That coalition slowly falling apart, dissolving under sort of pressure from the federal government, from Ontario also was very active in sort of trying to convince other provinces to move to break that coalition. Okay. So I think there was already a sense that this was...
I think that's right. It was weakening. People wanted, particularly the Anglo premiers, wanted a deal. They were desperate. They thought if this failed, Trudeau was going to do what he said he was going to do. He was going to go unilaterally, and they wouldn't get anything that they wanted. So it was falling apart. It was weakening. So it came. This noon event came, and so the question was, is this thing going to collapse? And for right up till 5 o'clock Wednesday, it looked like it was going to collapse. Or is there any type of compromise that might be a give? And as you just said, Mark, quite well, the deal was going to be, the compromise was going to be, and it was there in the background for weeks. It was in the papers. Everybody knew about it. We will trade you our amending formula. The Fed said, we will trade you our amending formula. We'll give up the referendum provision. We'll do all that. We'll go to your amending formula with some little glitch, particularly on compensation. And in exchange, you have to give us our charter. And they'll say, okay, we'll give you the charter, but we want this notwithstanding clause. You know what the more learned scholars...
I'm going to get Jamie to tell us about that.
But before we get to that, so that was what was there. So in the kitchen, this thing down the hall, a little kitchenette, Romano, Chrétien, and McMurtry, each representing a different party, each representing a different part of the country, old friends who had been to these constitutional battles forever, got together and said, what kind of deal might break this thing? And basically the deal was, we'll give you the provincial amending formula, you give us the charter with a notwithstanding. And they put that on a piece of paper. But Peckford put that on a separate piece of paper. Other people put that on a different piece of paper.
Okay, hold on there, Ron.
Let me finish, because this is really important. The point was, and this is where the myth comes in, is that Blakeney was really impressed by that piece of paper. Most people, Davis, Peckford, Law, he didn't know about the Kitchen Accord. They say it's a total fable. But Blakeney, through Romano, knew about it. And for the first time, he had in his hand a hint of what Ottawa might take. He said, we could be dreaming up provincial scenarios forever about what Ottawa... We actually have on this piece of paper what Ottawa might take. And that led him into the night, which we'll talk about.
Okay. I need a constitutional law prof right now.
Okay.
You're on, Jamie Cameron. The notwithstanding clause.
Right.
This was considered a huge breakthrough in that it represented a compromise that could potentially get this thing done. What did it mean?
Well, the notwithstanding clause, the override section 33 of the Charter, is a mechanism which allows legislatures to protect their legislation from provisions of the Charter. So that's why it's called the override. It comes into effect when a legislature decides that it wants to protect its legislation from the Charter, which means that the legislation cannot be challenged under the Charter as being in violation of the Charter.
So big picture here. Court makes a decision, provincial legislature doesn't like the decision, uses this override clause.
Yes, it can use it before or after.
And how long does it last for?
Lasts for 5 years. And the other thing I just have to say for accuracy is that Prime Minister Trudeau did agree to the notwithstanding clause, but he made sure that certain rights could not be overridden, and specifically the democratic rights, the right to vote, and the language rights. So that's the basic gist of the way the override works, and it was, you know, I hope we'll come back and talk about it a little bit later, because it's really interesting that such an important feature of the charter and of the 1982 Constitution, whether it's been used or not, came into the Constitution this way.
Well, let me pick up, Jennifer, let's pick up on that. Does the, having that override clause in the Constitution, in your view, diminish the value of the Charter of Rights and Freedoms?
That argument's been made a lot. It's the idea that we're holding it hostage. I mean, to put this in a bit more context, Section 1 of the Charter is the Reasonable Limits Clause, which says that, you know, nothing, this Charter is subject to the reasonable limits of a free and democratic society. So that means then that hate, we have freedom of speech, but hate speech is not permitted. So that's, our Charter is already limited. Then the notwithstanding clause is a political bargain, and it was essentially making the Charter more palatable to the provinces and giving them a bit of an escape hatch. The reality of the situation is the Charter is very popular. They have not been able to use it very often. In fact, sometimes they try and use it preemptively. Alberta's done this in the past. They'll attach the notwithstanding clause onto legislation that they think might be a bit dicey underneath the Charter. But that's a way of avoiding a big, prominent court case, because they know in the court of public opinion, it's very difficult to tell people, I'm sorry, we want to take away your rights.
Well, David, let's just follow up on that a little bit. If, you know, we have this Charter of Rights and Freedoms, you have all these wonderful rights that people have fought for over the years, except when our provincial legislature wants to pass a law saying you don't. Does that take away from the value of the Charter?
Well, rights are can be protected by courts, but not fully. Ultimately, I think it's a political fight to protect our rights and freedoms. It begs the question of whether the Charter of Rights actually has been as transformative as some people claim to our rights and freedoms in a day-to-day sense. And I would proffer this idea that it's been important. It's contributed, I think, to better public administration, fairer decision making. It's been important for some specific segments of society. For instance, gays and lesbians have been able to secure some guarantees and advantages through the Charter. But it's led to a status quo in regard to many other things. And in fact, in those areas where the court has said it's a reasonable limit, for instance, to require people to retire at 65, the court said that's a reasonable limit. We've done away with that in most jurisdictions. And there are other examples. The court has said it's okay to prohibit Sunday shopping. Right? It's a reasonable limit in Ontario, and then
yep, we have it.
Here we have it. Yeah. So you wonder then the extent to which the Charter has been transformative, or as transformative as is claimed. In which case, Section 33 really is a fight about how we go about talking and arguing about rights and freedoms.
Mm. Ron, I want you to come in at this point and tell the story about how late one night, Bill Davis, the Premier of Ontario, calls Pierre Trudeau, Davis, of course, one of the original I'm on board with you, Pierre, guys, phones him and says, if you don't compromise on this, I'm out.
Well, we left the saga at 5 o'clock with Blakeney saying, okay, I've got this Kitchener Court piece of paper. Peckford also had a piece of paper. There was the shift of deals. And so Blakeney said to a bunch of the guys, basically, why don't you meet in my suite, the Chateau Laurier, at 9 o'clock, and we'll see if we can make a deal that we might be able to sell to Ottawa based on the signal from Chrétien that there might be something that Ottawa would give in the trade. So a bunch of the guys, a couple of the premiers, not all of them, a bunch of civil servants, got together for about an hour and a half. It was so obvious, it was there. The trade-off would be your augmenting formula, our charter, a couple of little things, including notwithstanding clause and compensation on the top. And very quickly, among them all, they to almost to their surprise, they were able to put together a package that they agreed might be sellable to Ottawa. They didn't know, but they thought it was a pretty good chance. And therefore, they could stop Trudeau. And Davis Toussaint Hatfield, though, he was out partying that night. To an extent, Davis was brought into it saying, could you accept this? And when David signaled, yeah, I could accept that, then they said, oh, well, you might be able to break the Ottawa's gang of three. Okay. Mm-hmm. So at 10 o'clock, Trudeau's meeting at 24 Sussex with his ministers. And there's Chrétien particularly, you got it. There's a deal coming. It's going to be a compromise. You got to accept it. We can't go through anything. And Trudeau says, no, damn it. I'm going for a referendum. I'm going to UDI. I need my charter. It's got to be pure. Da, 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 da. And they're holding and they're divided. 10 o'clock at night. The game's over. And Davis phones Trudeau. Trudeau has to leave the room. And Davis gets on the phone and says, I've seen this thing. They're floating. And to me, I can buy it. And you, Pierre, with a couple little glitches, I think should take it. Because if you don't take it, I'm leaving. And I'm going to take Hatfield with me. And you'll be 10-0. And you go to London on that basis.
That burst the dam, didn't it?
That burst the dam. Because Trudeau comes out saying, 10-0. I mean, 2 is bad enough. 10-0. I mean, so he said to Chrétien, on the way out the door, if you can get me a deal that has the charter and notwithstanding and has that amending formula, I'll think about it. And that's when, and then of course we left with the question about Quebec not being invited that night, which
that's,
Martin, no doubt.
That's where I want to pick up. I want to pick up there. Martin, I'm going to go to you first on this. Ron, at the end of his book, asks a wonderfully provocative question, which is, we know this deal went down because the prime minister representing the federal government and 9 of the 10 premiers representing the provinces went for it. Quebec did not. And ever since then, that night in question has been portrayed in Quebec as the night of the long knives, the night of our humiliation, the night when Quebec was isolated, and so on and so forth. My question to you is this. Would it have been better had Trudeau just gone ahead unilaterally and said, to hell with any provincial representation, I don't care what I get, because then Quebec would not have been isolated, and maybe the last 30 years would have been entirely different when it comes to Quebec's place in Canada. What do you think?
That's an interesting what if. Yeah, quite frankly, I think that, well, maybe it would have been better in the sense that it's unlikely that Trudeau would have been able to go ahead and complete the repatriation process under that circumstances, under those circumstances, for political reason. I think that the optics of going ahead, essentially openly challenging the Supreme Court's interpretation of our Constitution based on the Constitutional Convention side of things, and going to London and asking the British Parliament to do something where the British Parliament had clearly indicated, Margaret Thatcher, the Prime Minister, but also other Member of Parliament, had clearly indicated that they were not exactly willing to follow through a unilateral demand from the federal government if there was not enough support from the provinces. So, you know, I think, quite frankly, it would have been unlikely unless there would have been a referendum, and then the referendum would have indicated clear support from the people. But what would have occurred probably under a referendum is, by the way, the Parti Québécois, the government of Parti Québécois, was re-elected in that period in Quebec, so had regained some of the legitimacy among the population that had lost after losing the referendum in 1980, and so would have. Well, I mean, it's pure speculation. We don't know. But chances are the PQ would have campaigned against that package in a referendum. And the result would have been very close in Quebec, if not in favor of the no. What do you do then? Then you have an even stronger opposition from Quebec with a sort of strong democratic mandate. You can no longer say that the government of Quebec, a separatist government, is not willing to reach an agreement, or the separatist government is not legitimate, and so on and so forth. There you have the people of Quebec. So the risk of a referendum, and I think that's why Lévesque was actually quite willing to go that route, is that the risk of a referendum in Quebec was fairly high for Trudeau. That was a big gamble. So I'm not sure we would have been much further ahead, quite
frankly.
Jamie,
let me ask you, if this had all gone down without Quebec having been isolated, let's say with no provincial support at all,
right,
would the last 30 years have been a lot more peaceful in Canada?
Well, I think so, but I just going back to what Trudeau actually did, I mean, he had the Supreme Court's blessing, because the Supreme Court said that substantial provincial consent was acceptable. And so from that point of view, you can see why although it was a political calculation that had to be made, you can see what the reasons were for going ahead on that basis at the time that he did. And it's awfully difficult to imagine what it might have looked like if things had been different. Personally, and I don't know what makes me say this, but I think that it would have been very, very risky for him to go it alone and try the UDI. I just don't know that as strong a person as he was, that he would have attempted that.
David, Brian Mulroney has often said there's not a chance in Hades that any federal government would have gone ahead and patriated a constitution without Ontario's signature. Right. What made them think they could do it and have it be legitimate without going with Quebec? What do you think?
So going with the nine and leaving Quebec out?
Yeah.
I think it was an expectation that the citizens of Quebec supported the initiative, that all of the Quebec MPs in the Liberal Party were, of course, behind.
Which was 74 out of 75 in Quebec at the time.
So with those, that's typically the mantra that gets trotted out by those who try and defend the position that the federal government took. In regards to the question, it's certainly aberrant, unfortunate, and I think regrettable, right, that Quebec was left out. It certainly
Quebec left out of that deal. Quebec's in.
Well,
they are covered, just because I know some people argue about that.
Sure.
They are covered.
And I'll be the first to acknowledge that, but they didn't sign on the dotted
line.
They
didn't sign on.
So, for lots of reasons, think that that's horrible. But I don't think it necessarily means that we would have had peaceful constitutional negotiations in the last 30 years, that we shouldn't underestimate the power of the Quebec nationalist movement. I think that it, you know, we would have seen manifestations of that in one way or another. We probably wouldn't have had as close a vote on the eve of that second referendum in 1995, which was exceptionally close, and the country hung in the balance. And Bouchard, the Quebec premier at the time, was able to capitalize on the role that Jean Chrétien played during the patriation exercise we're talking about. So it might not have been as close, and that's evidence of how the 1982 compromise has not turned out so well. But I do think that Quebec nationalism is a fact, right, that Canadians have to live with. Wouldn't have gone away necessarily if Quebec had signed on the dotted line.
Jennifer, the two arguments that we hear frequently is that Mr. Trudeau had 74 out of 75 seats in Quebec at the time, and therefore he could present himself as certainly representing Quebec. And the other thing they'd say is you had a separatist premier leading Quebec. René Lévesque wouldn't have signed anything ever under any circumstances. Do you agree with that?
Martin and I actually have had a whole conversation about this before coming in here today. I feel that Lévesque would have signed. He was part of the Gang of Eight, the original one, but that, again, that was without a Charter of Rights and Freedoms, which is an important point. Also, just to backtrack, because I'll let Martin answer the question about the representation issue, actually, mm-hmm. But in terms of going ahead without Quebec, remember, Trudeau had an alternative vision that really resisted the idea of Quebec as a nation. And so he was trying to advocate a different type of identification with Canada that was trying to diffuse, destroy, depending on which D word you want to use, the idea of Quebec as a nation within Canada and this narrative of two nations within this country. So that's kind of one thing that is important to keep in mind in terms of Trudeau. Also, in terms of the question of what about what would have happened had Trudeau gone unilaterally, I think you would have seen a total collapse of the country. I think that Newfoundland was making it very clear that it had no druthers and no sense of staying with the rest of Canada. Western Canada would have pulled away. I think that would have absolutely been a completely illegitimate decision.
Ron, let me just go back a little bit in time here. When it became apparent with that Bill Davis phone call to Pierre Trudeau that the logjam had been broken, that there was now the outline of an agreement, how hard did anybody try to get a hold of René Lévesque that night and say, look, the goalposts have moved, we need to talk?
There's a myth out there that this midnight deal was a fait accompli. It was the final deal that, first of all, nobody knew how Trudeau was going to react, except maybe Chrétien, because he had had this midnight conversation leaving 24 Sussex. It was an offer being put forward by the provinces, by the group of eight plus, by this point, Davis, to Trudeau, to the federal government. and nobody knew how to, and it was changeable. They went back into negotiations. So Levesque was presented this at breakfast. This is what happened overnight. Lougheed takes it away, takes him aside and says, you know, if you want to propose some changes, I'll be on your side. Put them forward on the table and let's talk. Sterling Lyon had gone back to Manitoba to fight in the election. He wasn't even there. Mm. He was told about the midnight deal after Levesque. And even he only came on conditionally. He never signed the damn thing either, so officially. So the sense that, it was a moving game. So they went back into Thursday morning. Changes were made Thursday morning. Important changes were made Thursday morning. And when the conference ended at the end of that day, very, very important changes, particularly in terms of language legislation, were made in the weeks following. But Quebec had absented itself using the Night of the Long Knives and this insult, which I agree was an insult, to basically say, oh, game over. They couldn't, and this gets back to the point we were talking about, they couldn't sign. Claude Morin, the book, and everybody agrees, they could not have signed a deal that contained a charter with language protection, because that would have protected the English schools inside Quebec and opened the ground for the Anglos, okay? And the most important thing in this debate is that the patriation was driven all through this decade, in Trudeau's mind, by really the charter. Patriation was a chance to get a charter. Mm-hmm. And what drove the charter? The language led to piece of it.
Okay, let me get to Martin, because I've got a couple of minutes left here. Martin, I want your view on whether or not the separatist premier of Quebec 30 years ago could have signed any document that would have made Canada stronger.
Oh, I think Levesque was actually quite willing to sign something. But as was said, there were two things that were non-negotiable for Quebec, that Quebec would have never signed a document that contained two things. One is, in the amending formula, it was pretty clear from the beginning that Quebec was not willing to sign a document that would allow a majority of Anglophone provinces with the federal government to change the power, the jurisdiction of Quebec, especially in matters of culture, education, and so on and so forth. So, and the amending formula as it stands now creates that possibility. Hence the insistence on Quebec on a veto or an opting out, a right of opting out with compensation. And so that's what the agreement of the Gang of Eight contained, and that's why Levesque was willing to go ahead with this. Now that that amending formula was accepted by Trudeau, but without veto and without opting out.
So
Quebec essentially lost.
Except on education and culture. It's not minor, as you say. This was one of the things that came afterwards. It was a very important amendment. They said,
if you
want financial compensation, we'll give it to you on your key points of education and culture. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And we will also not require you to protect the English schools as much as the English provinces will be protecting the French schools.
I just note, with our last 30 seconds to go here, there was a poll taken that was published, I guess, over the weekend. 80% support inside Quebec for repatriating the Constitution with a Charter of Rights and Freedoms as well. Take that for what it's worth. I want to thank everybody for participating on this program on the eve of the 30th anniversary of Canada's getting its own constitution. Jennifer Wallner from the University of Ottawa, Martin Papillon from the University of Ottawa. Merci beaucoup to both of you for being there in the nation's capital for us. Jamie Cameron from the Osgoode Hall Law School, David Schneiderman from the University of Toronto Law School, Ron Graham, and I would recommend The Last Act, Pierre Trudeau, The Gang of Eight, and The Fight for Canada. It's a great read about all of the events of 30 plus years ago. Thanks so much, everybody.
Support Ontario's public television. Donate at tvo.org.